What's your opinion on why this is still seen as such a controversial procedure? I mean, what can we do to more convince the cardiology community that myocardial bridges are real, they are symptomatic, and we've got all these case studies now, hundreds throughout the country, of people who have been improved as a result of the surgery?
Yeah, so I think I alluded to it earlier, that the fact that bridges are so common, right? We suspect 20 or 30% of all people have them. But then, and it's, all the surgeries that we've done for our patients have been very important and life-changing positively for almost all of them. But that's really only a small percentage, a fraction of a fraction of a percent of the entire population, right? So it's very real for the people that have it. How common it is to have a bridge and have it be pathologic or cause symptoms, I think is much, much more rare. So that's one thing. Then I also, right, medications, whether it be a beta blocker, a calcium channel blocker, you know, a nitrate-based medication, those are generally seen as pretty reasonable. But surgery for something like this seems quite radical, right? I mean, we've done lots of planning and have very good results for our patients, but it still is heart surgery, and is a risk that a coronary artery can be damaged. Sometimes the coronary arteries run through the ventricle, the heart can be opened up. You know, it's not without risk. And so at some point, there likely will be a major complication. And you know, humans have had myocardial bridges for the entirety of history, and we haven't conclusively demonstrated that it causes sudden cardiac death at a regular rate, you know, and it's something I understand how people are, you know, slow to accept. The medical community, the established medical community, is slow to accept it as a real problem. So I think more than convincing, it's really developing a good relationship with your physicians so that you can have a conversation. Because when I first heard about it in 2014, I was like, maybe I heard about this in medical school, but we certainly didn't pay any attention to it. So I look at it more developing good patient-physician relationships, being able to have a conversation about it. Our program is really continuing to do quite a bit of research into it. You know, what group of people is it most commonly in? What are the hemodynamic factors that, you know, predispose to having symptoms? What is the natural history? Is this a life threat? Can this be a life-threatening condition? Is this a life-threatening condition? You know, is there another medicine that could treat the symptoms that people could avoid having heart surgery for? You know, I think those are some of the reasons. And then we have still yet to collect beyond symptom surveys, so a significant amount of objective data or that hemodynamic data after the surgery, to show that the surgery has what it's changed physiologically, and you know, be able to make that connection from the bridge and its squeeze to the symptoms that you experience to, well, did those measurements change after the surgery, or how much of this is placebo component, right? Because you know, Dr. Schnicker cares about her patients and has developed that relationship with them. In separate instances, that in itself has been shown to be beneficial. And so I think all those reasons together, it's a common anatomic finding. We haven't consistently, well, we don't know if it's a risk for sudden cardiac death. We have seen some, you know, minor heart attacks from isolated bridges, how it plays a role in the development of coronary artery disease, kind of all those things together can contribute to why it's not universally accepted as a disease now.
Do you think the information that's being conveyed today is effective in getting more and more cardiologists to understand and at least appreciate the reality of the symptoms?
In the first 5 years that I was doing this, when patients would come and travel to us, right, the story we received was, you know, the physician that they were working with, you know, was not on board with them coming to our program to see it. And sometimes, you know, involving a different group of physicians stress that relationship with their primary doctors. that seems to be less common now, in that I think, well, your podcast, I don't know how many listeners you had, and certainly the Facebook group and the literature that our group has published is bringing it to awareness.